Well, good morning, and welcome to Asylum Hill Congregational Church, an open and affirming congregation in the United Church of Christ. This means that no matter who you are, no matter where you are on your spiritual journey, we say welcome. Welcome. We are thrilled and honored to connect with each and every one of you and to worship God together. So welcome to those of you who are live streaming, those of you who may be catching our service later on in the week, and welcome to those of you who are here in our sanctuary. Friends, it is not just helpful, but it is really important that we continue to know who is worshiping with us, who we are connecting with. So I would ask that in this moment or in a moment to come during the day that you would take a minute to fill out our virtual pew pad, which you can find at ahcc.org. While you are there, you may also want to put in a prayer request, a virtual prayer request. This helps us, your pastors, to know what is on your heart and mind and how we can best lift you in prayer throughout the week. I would ask that you would continue to subscribe to our Friday email. If you are not subscribed, I would ask that you just call our front office and make sure that you get your name into that subscription. That I would ask, as I have in the past, that you not only make sure you are subscribed, but that when the email comes to your inbox on Friday, that you open it, and that then you take a few minutes to actually read through it. There is so much information about programming, about ministry opportunities, about events happening in the life of this congregation, and we want to make sure that you know about each and every one of them. It's also important, we also put out a lot of information on social media, and so whatever your social media platform is, I would make sure that you are also connected with AHCC in that way as well. A couple of quick reminders. One is our nursery is actually closed today due to illness. So if there is anyone here who has little ones, please be reminded that we do have a children's corner set up in the back of the sanctuary. You can utilize that for today. After worship, because of the wonderful rain that we are receiving that is nourishing our earth today, our Love Our Earth event, a fair which is happening, which we had planned for the parking lot, will be happening in Drew Hall. So we would love after the service for you to head into Drew Hall, grab a cup of coffee, have some conversation, and there is some really interesting booths set up with lots of information. Also, we had planned to also have in our parking lot the, I forget what it's called, but the van, which is an, what is it called, Peter? Energy CT interactive van. Thank you. So that will actually be parked right outside the doors to our sanctuary on 814 Asylum Ave. So if you would like to head out to the van as well, we're trying to get it as close as possible so that you don't have to spend too much time in the rain. But the van out front and Drew Hall will have our booths with the fair set up. So thank you to our climate action team for making the transition today and for making this event possible. Also, 1 o'clock, our free weekly meal will be taking place in the parking lot, and we remember that is rain, shine, snow, any kind of weather event, so that will again be taking place. Jack has two announcements for us.
Good morning. Two things related to
the first is you may have seen on the scrolling announcements, if you were here for those, that for Mother's Day, we are again doing our annual tradition of having a men's choir. So we give the sopranos and altos in the choir the morning off in terms of singing. We will rehearse on Tuesday, May 9th, and this will involve a dinner and rehearsal from 6:30 to 8:30 p.m., and then we will sing on May 14th, Mother's Day, in the worship service, one piece of music. So if you are a tenor or a bass and you want to be a part of that, please come to that Tuesday rehearsal and then sing with us on the Sunday morning. And the second thing is, you've been aware, I'm sure, of the mandala exhibit that has been up in Drew Hall since the beginning of Lent. That will be coming down soon. However, all of those are for sale. And all the proceeds from that will go to the Music and Arts Ministries, which is a wonderful, generous gift from the artist. If you are interested in that, please see me. Thank you.
Thank you, Jack. And then last but not least, next Sunday, we will begin our season of stewardship here at AHCC. We will kick off our annual giving campaign. You will be receiving materials in your mailboxes this week. And we are going to kick this off with a breakfast, with an all-church breakfast next week, beginning at 8:45 in the morning. So we hope to see many, many, many of you here in person. Come for the breakfast, stay for worship as we kick off our season of stewardship at AHCC. Friends, let us take a deep breath together. Let us bring our hearts, our minds, our spirits into a time of worship. And if you would rise in body or in spirit and join me in our responsive call to worship. Beloveds, come out. Come out of the darkness of doubt. We come seeking the light. Open your hearts to receive God's healing love. Lord, help us to see you and to feel your loving presence. This morning, as we bring our hearts to a time of prayer, I would ask that we would lift the following folks. We pray prayers of joy for Bev Sear, whose daughter gave birth to Hallie Claire on Tuesday. We are grateful beyond measure that Jim Morgan, who suffered a stroke in Pennsylvania, has returned to Connecticut. We pray prayers of healing and recovery for Yolanda Liarno's daughter, Jacinda, and for Deidre McGarry, who was transferred to Gaylord. And we grieve with those who are grieving. We grieve those who are grieving the loss of Tony Adazio, Nancy Brown, and her daughter. We grieve the loss of John Cronin. We grieve with Betty and their family. We grieve with those who love Julie Slimmons, who died this week, and Ellen Franklin, who died just last night. And we are with the community here on Huntington Street and with the Pierce family as they grieve the loss of their beloved Secret. Friends, let us bring our hearts, our minds, our spirits into prayer. Let us pray. We will open with a moment of quiet and silence for you to lift to God your own prayers, those things which quietly, intimately reside on your own hearts. Splattering the black-blue night with the twinkling stars and spinning fluffy clouds out of the fabric of your hope. You raised creation out of chaos, gracious God, giving life and calling it good. Walking with disciples down grief's lonely road, you sang of how God had raised you from the dead so that listening they might believe, believing they might understand, understanding they might obey, going forth to invite all to follow you, bread of life, to feast on your love forever. And reaching out your love to us so that we would touch others. We give thanks that we are filled with your gifts so that we might be a blessing to the world, piercing our darkness with hope so that we might bring healing to the broken. You raise us to new life, Spirit of God. We pray for all of the joys being experienced by people here, by people near, by people far. We pray for all of the grief that people are experiencing here. People near, for people far. God, we know that you are with us in both our joys and our sorrows. So God, in community, we raise now our voices to you. Hear us as we pray, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Friends, on Friday afternoon, your minister for early life, Jordan Rebholz, and the director of Early Life Ministries here, Toby Aubert, left on a mission trip with our high school youth group to Boston. This is a picture, I believe, of them as they were in our parking lot getting ready to go, and we have been receiving pictures and updates throughout the weekend. They are having a wonderful time together. I want to say that this is one of the many ministry areas that your gifts go to support. Early Life Ministry is a wonderful, wonderful ministry team here at Asylum Hill Congregational Church. And I want to make sure that you know when you give, this is one of the ministry programs that we get to support. And this is an area that really shapes the experiences that these young people have, shape their faith journeys. The experiences that young people have through this church, they actually grow up into decent human beings. And isn't that what we're trying to do as a community? Is to grow up the next generation, to be the kind of people who are kind and caring and committed to the ways of Jesus in the world. That's what we're doing on this trip to Boston. And that's what you do in your giving, is support the generation that comes after you to be good human beings. So friends, as we receive now a wonderful gift of music, let us receive our gifts, our tithes, and our offerings.
Thank you.
Gracious and loving God, bless the gifts that we give. Bless the gifts that we give so that they may, like our high school students, go out into the world serving the ways of Jesus, helping us to bring about the kingdom here on earth as it is in heaven. So bless our gifts and bless us. In your name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. Our gospel reading today is from the Gospel of Luke, and it's from the last chapter of Luke. It is a post-resurrection story, and it is well known as the walk to Emmaus. So let us listen together for a word from the Lord. Now on that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still for a moment, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it was just as the women had said, but they did not see him. Then he said to them, "Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe that all the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory? Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures." Well, as they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us, because it is almost evening and the day is now nearly over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed it, broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were open, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?" Well, that same hour, they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, "The Lord is risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon." Then they told what had happened on the road and how they had been made known to them in the breaking This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. God, we are grateful. We are grateful today that you come in the breaking. That you come in the breaking of bread and in the breaking open of our hearts. Be with us as we think about, as we feel, as we experience this text in the world today. Amen. So friends, we're 2 weeks, 14 days post-Easter. Last week, we heard a terrific sermon about the story of Doubting Thomas, right? The disciples are locked in a room somewhere in Jerusalem, and Jesus appears. And today, we have the story of the road to Emmaus. These are rich, rich and beautiful post-resurrection stories. And it's easy, because of our need and desire, to stretch these stories out over the course of a few weeks. And to begin, if we might even begin to think that these stories, like we do in church settings, happened sort of over the course of some time, some days, of some weeks. But I want us to look at the text, and I want us to recognize that today's story didn't take place, as we're hearing it, 2 weeks after the resurrection, when folks would have had time to kind of take in and process a little bit, even be with and talk with others. No. The text starts by saying the story took place on that same day. On the day in which early in the morning Mary went to the tomb and found the stone rolled away, on the same day she begged the gardener to give her back Jesus' body, on the same day Jesus called her by name and her eyes were opened and she saw the risen Christ. And what I love about this collection of post-resurrection stories is that when we understand them as a collection, we really begin to get a clear picture of what life was like for folks in Jerusalem on the first day of the week. What it was like for people who did not yet understand the power of resurrection, who didn't know what God had been up to. And friends, if we're honest, when we look at this collection of post-Easter resurrection stories, it's not about lilies and trumpets and alleluias, nor is it about baskets and bunnies and bonnets. People were in shock. People were traumatized. People were in total disbelief at what they had just seen happen. People were scared out of their minds. These last chapters of all of the Gospels really speak about a terrifying experience. People wondered, am I next? People were angry. And so folks hid themselves, like we heard last week, behind locked doors. People were afraid to say what they saw or believed. People began to scatter, hightailing it out of Jerusalem as fast as they could. And that's where we find our two disciples today. Two men who had been following Jesus and were told they were out. leaving Jerusalem, headed for a village, a small town about 7 miles, the text says, from Jerusalem, that they went to a place called Emmaus. And we heard the story. While they were on their way, they encounter a man who begins to walk with them. And as they walk, the man asks what they are discussing amongst themselves. And I love the response they give. Are you the only man in Jerusalem that does not know what has happened there in these days? And then presumably for a few hours, as 7 miles is not around the corner, they begin to tell this man everything that had taken place. I have to tell you, I have preached on this text at least probably a dozen times in my ministerial career. But this year, it has landed so differently. It seems ever since Easter, I too have been on the road to Emmaus. Many times over the last couple of weeks, I have found myself saying to Jesus, "Are you the only one that does not know what is happening here? Do you not know about the mass of plastic debris and chemical sludge lurking in the Pacific Ocean, a mass that is the literal size of the United States? Do you not understand what is happening? Extreme heat, drought, deadly storms, rising seas. I mean, it's too hot, it's too cold, it's too wet, it's too dry, it's too much, it's too little, it's too late, it's too soon. Do you not care that babies are now being born pre-polluted?" I found myself over the last couple of weeks saying, "Jesus, do you see what's going on here? A man just shot a 16-year-old boy for ringing the wrong doorbell. A man just shot a young woman, 20 years old, for driving up the wrong driveway. A man just shot a cheerleader for mistaking his car for her own in a parking garage. Jesus, are you the only one here today that doesn't know that on Thursday evening at 8:40, while this church was brimming with activity, singers singing, instrumentalists playing, dancers dancing, children laughing, that two men drove down this street, which is 10 feet from where you are sitting on this side of the church. The two men drove down this street and opened fire, shooting 3 men and killing 12-year-old Secret. So yeah, I understand the disciples' exasperation as they walk the road to Emmaus and question how in the world this man does not know about the horrors that took place in Jerusalem, about the horrors that are taking place in our nation, in our city, and in our neighborhood. The ingenious Hidalgo Don Quixote of La Mancha, frequently shortened to Don Quixote, is a book that was written by Spanish author Cervantes in the 16th century. The main character, Don Quixote, is a man who is deemed insane by society, yet is on a mission to become a knight and reclaim chivalry. In one of the book's most well-known scenes, Quixote, believing windmills are to be evil giants, he tilts his lance at them, believing he can actually bring them down. Well, unfortunately, the windmill breaks his lance and drags him and his horse along the ground. And on the one hand, Don Quixote's misadventures with evil windmills might represent imaginary enemies, those misguided fights that we romanticize or idealize in our minds. We come to believe that the other, the one whom we are so intent in overcoming, might just be giants. However, on the other hand, there's an argument to be made that Quixote's windmill interactions might also represent a sense of imagination that resists the limitations of a current reality, a vision that rejects the vices of skepticism and mistrust, a commitment to living a life that does not depend on outcomes, but is totally dependent upon faith. So on one hand, Quixote's misadventures with evil windmills might be seen as misguided. And on the other hand, it could be incredible imagination. In the 1970s, the story of Don Quixote was made into a musical under the title The Man of La Mancha. And one of the great songs from that musical is Impossible Dreams. And I'm sure I now have put that into your head. I will not be singing it for you today. No one wants that, not even me. But it speaks directly to this idea, this power of imagination, to dream the impossible dream, to fight the unbeatable foe, to bear with unbearable sorrow, and to run where the brave dare not go, to right the unrightable wrong, and to love pure and chaste from afar, to try when your arms are too weary, to reach that unreachable star. This is my quest, to follow the star, no matter how hopeless, no matter how far, to fight for the right, without question or pause, to be willing to march into hell for that heavenly cause. And I know if I'll only be true to this glorious quest, that my heart will lie peaceful and calm when I'm laid to rest. And the world will be better for this, that one man, scorned and covered with scars, still strove with his last ounce of courage to reach the unreachable. And I'll always dream the impossible dream. Yes, and I'll reach the unreachable star. Friends, if you listen to that, this is a song about hope. This is Easter hope. That day when the impossible dream was realized. Yesterday afternoon, a couple hundred people gathered here in the sanctuary to experience Jeffrey Hudson's A Passion for the Planet, which was an hour-long oratorio on the subject of climate change. blending scientific prose, poetry, and sacred texts from many different faiths. The libretto traces an arc from beauty and gratitude into darkness and out again into hope. It was nothing short of spectacular. It was hard. It was sad. It made me anxious and scared, and it was beautiful and thought-provoking and so full of hope. Not a passive hope, but a hope that requires imagination, that requires us to dream impossible dreams, a hope that requires us to believe that resurrection is indeed still possible. One of the songs near the end of the oratorio is Hope is a Verb. Hope is a verb, it says, with its sleeves rolled up. Hope is patient, it's steady and competent and brave. It requires courage. Hope is practical. Hope is a discipline that requires skill. Hope is something we do, and with hope, we can create positive change that can redeem the earth. Hope is a verb with its sleeves rolled up. Following the concert, many of us left the sanctuary and walked down Huntington Street to stand in solidarity with the Pierce family who lost their 12-year-old secret on Thursday night. It was horrifically sad. It felt almost impossible to bear witness to Bianca, Secret's mother's grief. It was uncomfortable to hear hard truths being spoken. If I'm honest, it made me anxious and scared. And it was beautiful and so full of hope. This wasn't a moment where we were talking about us and them. It was about who we are as a community. It was about showing up. It was about bearing witness. It was about allowing our hearts and minds to be transformed by both grief and love and hope. Beloveds, they had seen it. They had seen it with their very own eyes. He had died. And there was really none among them who at that time was daring to dream an impossible dream. It was too dangerous, it was too scary, and they were absolutely too heartbroken. But we're told that when they sat down to have a meal together, the man they were with took bread and broke it and gave it to them. And we're told that in the breaking of the bread, they recognized Jesus and they believed he was alive. In that moment, the impossible was taken off the table and the dream of resurrection became a reality. In the same way, I believe that in the breaking open of our own hearts, when we have the courage to do what is uncomfortable and countercultural, and what might lead some to call us quixotes, it's there. It's there that God shows up. When we have the courage to imagine what could be and then work for what will be, friends, Jesus walks right alongside us. At the very end of the vigil last night, organizers asked if there were any children or young people who were there. And they asked children and young people who were there to gather in the center of the crowd. There were neighbors, there were friends, there were cousins, family. There was a 5-year-old boy, 10-year-old girl, 12-year-olds, 15-year-olds. And the organizer said, "I'm going to count to three. And you know what to shout." And she said, "One, two, three." And all the children raised their hands and shouted to the heavens together, "Alleluia!" Friends, I'm just going to say before we close, what a gift to walk off and need to find a tissue. And Frank Vernelli, who runs our cameras, just offered me his handkerchief. Thank you, Frank. Friends, on the count of three, I'd like you know what to say. One, two, three. Alleluia. Amen. Go in peace.